In this video, we're going to look at different types of bindings and turnings that you might do on leather. This isn't something that everybody's going to need. It depends on what kind of projects you're doing. But when I did the requests video, you know, what things people wanted to see, one of the things that cropped up was different types of bindings. So that's what we're going to look at. Most of the things we're going to look at are covered in this book. If you haven't got this book, I'd recommend you go and buy it because it's very good. It's the Leatherworking Handbook by Valerie Michael, and the examples that I'll show will be drawn directly from this. So if you want a written reference for these things, then you should go and pick this book up on Amazon. There's a few different ways of doing bindings and turnings, so we'll cover just three or four different things. These aren't live projects that I'm showing you, they're just going to be little small scale examples. Because I don't have anything really on the bench, well, apart from one item that we'll see that's really using these. So most of these are just small scale examples, but you can obviously take the techniques and use them on whatever you're doing yourself. These aren't the be all and end all of this. You can kind of combine a lot of these different techniques together to achieve what you want. You know, so you're not limited to these particular things. It should just give you the ideas that you need to go forward and use it in your own projects. So I hope you're going to find this useful. It shouldn't be too long. But as always, if you want to skip to a particular example, just use the little index down in the video description. I know some people have been struggling to find video descriptions. YouTube kind of hides the description by default now. There's a little thing underneath the video that says more or something. If you click that, you'll find that's where I stick all of the information that you need about the video. So do have a look in those. There's a link to my website always in there. And there's lots of information on there and an FAQ about the videos. With lots of questions that people tend to ask. So do have a look in there because you'll probably find out answers to things that you might be wondering about. Okay, so we'll get started now and have a look at some of these bindings. So the first thing I'm going to do is put a new skiver blade in. You need to be ever so careful doing this because these are basically sort of little razor blades and they will just open your finger up like nobody's business if you're not careful. So I tend to try and push the very edges in just with my fingernail, and then just don't put your hand anywhere near it. It is called a safety beveler, but it's not particularly safe putting the blades in, so be very careful. So we've got a thin piece of leather here. This is buffalo calf, and the thickness on this should be about a millimeter. I would think if we just put that in there, it's actually less. That's 0.8 millimeters. So that's the kind of thickness that we're dealing with. And if I was using this on a wallet or some sort of pouch or something like that, generally if it was a single thickness, then I would now be turning this over. If you were to leave something as thin as that as an actual edge, it's quite soft and floppy, and over time you know, it's going to wrinkle up and it's sort of not that nice to the touch and so on. So this is a good example of where you might turn this over. So in order to do a turnover, you have what's called a turnover allowance, and that's the amount that you're going to turn back on itself. Now generally with something like this I would do about a centimetre. You could do more, you could do less, it depends on what particular thing you're doing, but for this example we'll do a centimetre. So this little strip thing that I've got is 10mm. So I'm going to mark down there 10mm. So if we were making up a pattern or something like that, then where I've made that line, that would be the actual edge as such. That 10mm there is the turnover allowance, so that's going to actually sort of disappear as such when we turn this over. So if you were measuring out a wallet and you measured out where the top edge was, you'd need to actually add the amount of turnover. What I'm also going to do here, just for simplicity, is I'm going to mark another line so you can see where it's coming to. If you were doing this normally, I wouldn't mark this line here because you'd probably see it on the inside if you weren't careful. So we're going to turn this 10mm here over and stick it to this 10mm here. Well, I would normally mark a guideline, but I'd mark it at like 9mm or 8mm or something so that I was coming just over it and you wouldn't see it. I've just marked that equal for simplicity's sake there. So that is going to turn over and stick onto that. Now, the first thing that we need to do is we need to skive down this part here, because if we turn that over at full thickness, it's going to be quite bulky and it's going to be quite difficult to turn. So what we need to do is we need to carefully skive back. Now, we want to skive back from behind where we turn so that we're thinning down the part that turns over. but we don't want to skive all the way back to this line here. So what we want to do is we want to come back maybe a third or halfway in between these two lines and then carefully skive. Now, before you start skiving a big piece of expensive leather, practice on the scrap of the same leather if you're not used to it, because otherwise what you're going to do, if we just go down to this end, is you're going to go, right, I'm going to start skiving in and go, oh, crap, I've just skived a massive hole in this piece of leather, and start again. You need to, especially on thin leather, you need to practice quite a lot in order to get the correct sort of angle and control and so on with your skiver, otherwise you will just skive holes in stuff. I've been using this quite a lot, so hopefully we won't make a mess of it. So come in, say, I'll just show you where I'm putting the end of the blade. Let's say it's about a third there. So if I actually just put a little dashed line there, that'd be about where I'm skiving from. So I'm going to carefully skive back from that dashed line down. And because it's only thin leather, I'm not trying to remove a lot of material. You know, if you've got 0.8mm, you're talking about taking something like 0.4mm of leather away here, and that's actually quite a small amount, really. But it does make all the difference. There's no way to rush this if you're doing it by hand. When they do this in factories and things, they have a machine called a skiving machine, and it runs it sideways through the machine. So you set the machine up, and then what you would do is you would put this in and it would pull it sideways that way, and it does all this for you. Obviously we don't have one of those here. So there we go, we've skived that bit down there and just thinned that down. You can see in a couple of places I've gone too much there. As always, when I'm trying to film something, it's not going to be done as well as if I'm doing it properly, because I'm talking at the same time. So what I'm then going to do is I'm going to remark on that line, because obviously I've just skived it away. So we've then got the guideline on there again, and then this is all thinned down. So the next thing I need to do is I need to suggest the fold to the leather. And we do that using a bone folder and steel ruler. Now, you could dampen this down to help, but honestly, with something this thin, it's not going to make that much of a difference with this kind of leather. But if you find you're struggling to do this, you could try dampening it down as well. So I'm going to place the steel ruler against the line. I'm going to take the bone folder. You can get these bone folders all over the place. Tandy do sell them, but this one's just from a craft shop, because they're used in card craft and things like that as well. It's just a piece of plastic these days. So lay the ruler against the guideline, slide the bone folder underneath. Obviously try not to mash this, because this is actually part of the finished leather, you know, so don't make a mess of this edge of it. Carefully pick it up. Then what you want to do is just run this bone folder down and then slowly work it up to vertical like that, so that what you're doing is you're basically bending this through 90 degrees. You've got like a right angle on this now. And then basically just work the bone folder up and down and try and sort of almost as if you're trying to bend it over the ruler. And just do that a few times, and what you're doing there is just suggesting the point at which that leather is going to fold over, and you can see it's actually trying to sit there now at 90 degrees. Once you've done that, what you then need to do is apply your glue. So I'm going to apply the contact cement to this. Now, when you do this, you need to apply it to the towards the outside, because if you apply it towards the inside, obviously if you go too far, you're going to be getting glue on the inside of your item. So you need to come up to your guideline and then just glue backwards towards the outside, being careful not to go over your guideline, because if you do, you're going to get that on the inside. Now, contact cement will roll up and rub off anyway on this kind of leather. So if you do get a little bit too much on there, don't worry about it too much. You'll find if you rub it with your finger, you can make a little ball of it and get rid of it. But it's best to do it neat first time. So make sure we've glued nicely up to the guideline and right down to the edge there. Obviously trying not to get glue on the outside of there. And then, like all contact adhesive, we need to leave that until it goes sticky. So it just needs a few minutes now to sit until it tacks up. So once that glue's been given a couple of minutes to go sticky there and it's ready to turn over, don't rush that, because you know it needs to have that little bit of curing time to have its effectiveness. So don't give it 10 seconds and then think, you know, I'll sod it, I'll crack on, you know, have patience with it. So once it's done that, what I do is I just try and use the bone folder again to get it turned up. Now I put the ruler back on, but rather than putting the ruler flat like that, because it's just going to stick to all the glue, I try and put it on a little bit of an angle so that I've just got the edge of the ruler against the line. And this bit is a bit tricky. So I've got that on an angle there, and I've got the just the edge touching. And then I'm going to do just what I did before. I'm going to basically resuggest that line there. So I'm just coming again with the bone folder, rubbing it up and down against the edge of the ruler, but with the ruler on an angle. And once I've done that, I'm then going to take the ruler away, and you can see that that's not sticking too badly there. So what we do then is we basically just carefully push this over and stick it down. So coming to the guideline that we've made there, keeping everything nice and even and level as much as we can. And what I try and do is I try and stick it to the guideline first, and then what I do is I'll push backwards. So I've got my thumb there and I'm pushing in this direction towards the edge in order to actually flatten that down. There we go, that's stuck down. And then once you've done that, it basically needs flattening. Now the best way to do that, if you've got one, is with one of these flat faced cobbler's hammers. If you haven't, there's various other things you can get. You can get these kind of things, which are rollers, or you can just rub it with your bone folder. But the best way, usually, as I say, if you've got one, is one of these cobbler's hammers. If you can't find one of these for sale new, there's a load of these always on eBay. So basically just give that a tap then. And you can also use this to rub as well. So tap and a rub. Like that. And what that does is just sets that edge down nice and flat and makes sure your glue is stuck nicely. And that's it, that's your turned edge. Now if you wanted to, you could also stitch that down, but it depends on the item that you're making. Usually you probably shouldn't need to stitch something like that down if it's on the inside of an item. If you wanted to do it for decorative reasons, you could, but ordinarily, as long as that's not going to be under any undue stress or anything, that should be fine just as it is. As I say, you can see that pen mark on the inside there, that's just because I marked it at the same distance. If I'd have marked that a millimetre back, it would have come just over there and it would be invisible. But that's it, that's created basically your turned edge there. So for a real example of that, this is a wallet that I'm in the middle of making, which will be used in a couple of these demonstrations. And you can see that this edge on the wallet here has had that done on. So this full top edge there is rolled over, and you can see that that gives that a nice edge on the top of the wallet there. Now one thing that is tricky with this kind of a turnover is if you want to do a long turnover. Now that's obviously, what, I don't know, 6 centimetres, 7 centimetres, it's fairly easy to do. If you wanted to turn something over that was, you know, 30, 40 centimetres long, how would you manage to do that with your fingers without making a real mess of it? Well, there's machines that you can buy, edge folding machines, and if in sort of production factories, that's what they have. And it's basically a long table as such. You place the leather so that you turn is against the edge of the table, and then you pull a lever, and when you pull the lever, basically it clamps the leather down, and then a section folds up like this and actually folds the leather all at once to keep it nice and straight. Those are quite expensive and large, like all industrial leather machines. Something that I made, which I used to help get that on the camera, something which I made is basically this, and all it is two pieces of wood with two hinges on. It's literally as low tech as that, but you can use this for doing the same sort of thing. It's obviously not as good as a proper machine, but it can help. Something else to consider with the turnover allowance is if you're doing upholstery or you're making clothes or some other things like that, you may need to make sort of panels, essentially, leather panels. So if you've got a leather settee, if you go look at that leather settee now, you'll probably find that it's not made out of like one big piece of leather for each cushion, for example, because by the time they've cut round like any faults in the hide and things like that, you don't really get often pieces that are that big unless it's very, very high quality. So what you'll see is that it's like the cushions and things or the seat backs are made out of multiple pieces, or if you've got like a leather jacket or a waistcoat, you'll see again, obviously, it's cut from lots of different pieces joined together. Now, when you put thin pieces of leather like that together, often you can use this idea of a turnover in order to make the seams look better. So that's the turnover that we just did, which I've cut off because we're reusing this piece of leather for an example. But if you imagine that these pieces were much bigger and I wanted to join them together, if I just overlap two edges, it doesn't look very nice. Whereas if I do a turnover here and then place that onto the next panel, so if you imagine this is going to be on the inside, if I put that there and then stitch these together, what you've got is you've got your nice turned edge, and then you've got obviously your skin side of your leather coming under that turned edge. And if you imagine that was a cushion or a jacket, and then the jacket was lined, you obviously wouldn't then see any edges there. So that's the other place where that can be used. So the next thing that we'll do is looking at adding a binding piece to a normal edge, a separate binding piece. So let's say that we have an edge on some leather. Now this could be one piece of leather or two pieces of leather or three pieces, however it's come together in the project. Let's just imagine there's an edge, a cut edge. So that there would be a solid edge, and if this was a sheath or anything else, we could bevel and burnish this edge if we wanted to. But let's say for what we're doing in the project, we want to bind the edge. So in this example, there's two pieces of leather there which I've glued together to give that edge. What we're going to do is we're going to put over another piece of leather which is going to basically wrap around and bind that edge, so you won't see this. It's going to be hidden. So the first thing to do is to measure how thick the leather is, what thickness we've got. Now normally I'd use my vernier gauge for this, but the battery's run out. So we'll do it old school with a ruler. And I've got 6 millimetres of leather there, so there must be 2-3 millimetre pieces. So what we do is we take that thickness, which is 6, and we add another 12mm. And that other 12mm is 6mm for this side and 6mm for this side, or about a quarter of an inch. So what that gives us altogether is the 12 and the 6, which is 18mm. So I need to cut a strip of leather which is 18mm wide. So there's a strip of leather which is 18mm. So what I will do is I will mark where I want to glue this on either side, and to do that I'll mark a guide with the wing dividers. So I'll set the wing dividers at 6mm, so just about there actually, 6mm, and then what I'll do is I'll mark a guide down there and a guide down there. Once I've marked the guide, I'm going to bevel the edge. The reason that I'm going to bevel the edge is just so that when this rolls round, it's not rolling round a 90 degree corner, it's got a curve to roll round, which should give it a nicer appearance once it's all glued and everything. So take that edge off there, take that edge off there. So the next thing to do is to actually glue the strip over there. So what we'll do is, rather than trying to glue the whole thing at once, we'll glue one side, let it dry so that it's nice and strong, and then turn it over and glue it on the other side. So again, same as when we did the turnover, working in from the line so that we're not getting glue where we shouldn't have glue. And apply some glue to half of the binding. So once that's had time to go sticky, as always, you need to follow the instructions on the actual glue that you're using. It's always going to tell you on the pot how to use it. We can then carefully stick this to one side. Obviously, doing such a small example as this, it's easier than doing something large. You're going to have to do this very carefully if you're doing something quite large. There's no point in me doing a huge example though. So I'm going to lay that along the line there, the guideline, stick that down. Again, can't emphasise enough how much one of these cobbler's hammers is going to come in handy if you're doing any of these turnings and bindings. I'm going to tap that now. Just to make sure that's nicely stuck. Now, in reality, if you were doing this for real, you'd want to give that glue time to dry nicely there and achieve some strength before you start pulling this round to the other side. For simplicity's sake, I'm just going to do this other side now, but you know, ordinarily you would want to leave that, because as you start to pull this over, you don't want to be pulling it off this side, so you should leave it for you know, a few hours or a day, or however long your glue needs to achieve some strength. But as I say, just because this is really just seeing how it goes together, it's not a real project. We'll just go and do this other side straight away. So I'm going to apply glue to this side as well. Again, coming up to that guideline there. So once that's gone sticky, this can be rolled over. Now, don't try and just whack the whole thing over at once. When you do anything like this, it's best to use your bone folder and work it round slowly so that it all adheres properly, otherwise you'll end up with kind of air bubbles and gaps in it. So because I've rolled that edge, the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to apply pressure, and I'm going to just roll that over to start to stick to that rolled edge. You can see that's now holding that up in the air a bit. And then I'm going to take the bone folder and I'm going to rub this to stick it to the flat part of the edge, slowly working that over. And I'm slowly sort of turning the bone folder from through an angle like that, so that it's conforming to the roll of the edge. And then once you've got that stuck to the edge nicely, you can just use your thumbs then to roll that over the rest of the way. Hammer down. So what you need to do then is you need to give that time to dry before you try and stitch it, because obviously you're going to pull it all out of place. So it would actually take you a couple of days really to do this properly, because you'd need to glue it to the one side, let the glue dry so it's nice and strong, turn it over, glue it to the other side, again let the glue dry so it's nice and strong, and then come back and stitch it. So it's not really something that you would rush, because to keep it neat, which obviously this isn't because it's just a quick example, you would want to give it time to dry properly each stage. As I say, because this is a quick example, we'll go ahead and actually just do the stitching now. So once you've let that dry, you need to come inside obviously the margins of the binding and do your stitching. So what I'll do is I'll mark these dividers at about 4 millimeters, which comes inside the 6 millimeters that we've allowed. Slightly more than that on there, and mark a stitch line. Once you've marked your stitch line, you can stitch it in whatever method you prefer. I did a video about stitching the other day if you want to learn about these pricking irons and things. There you go, that's stitched down there very quickly, just to give you an idea of what that looks like. And obviously that looks the same on both sides, because there's no, you know, you wrap it around an equal amount and saddle stitch it through, it gives a, there's no front and back to it as such. So that's that example there. So you know, you probably wouldn't do that on something like a knife sheath or something, but if you're making a bag, you know, a handbag or something like that, then that may be an example of where you'd use that. Obviously, the way we've turned that over, you do actually have a cut edge here and on the back. You know, we haven't actually turned over the binding leather itself. If you wanted to, you could turn over the binding leather, so you could combine the first example that we did, the turnover on the binding strip. So where we've measured that and we've said, okay, you know, we need 6 millimeters and 6 millimeters and 6 millimeters to give 18. What you could then do is you could add another centimetre on each side, so you've got 38, fold that 10 in on either side to get you back to 18, that gives you two turned edges, and then use that strip of leather with the two turned edges as a binding strip. So what you've then done is you've hidden the cut edge and you've got a turned edge on either side of the binding. That would be taking that to the next level if you were making something that was a higher quality item. And you've got, you know, many of these techniques can be combined together, but that's an option that you've got there as well. Okay, so the next thing that we'll look at is what's called a French binding, and I've also heard this referred to as a roll. I don't know if that's a term that's used in America a lot, but sometimes it's referred to as like a roll. And a French binding, this is for when you want to line a piece of leather and you also want to form a binding with the lining at the same time. And this is something that you can use on all different items, and it's very useful. So why would you line a piece of leather at all? Well, obviously you've got two sides to leather. You've got your skin side, which is your finished side, and you've got your flesh side, which is your unfinished side or the inside. Sometimes, depending on what kind of item it is, it's desirable to line the inside. If it was like a bag, for example, like a handbag, you maybe wouldn't leave just the flesh side of leather on the inside of the bag, because every time you looked in the bag, you'd be seeing that. That's as opposed to maybe a pouch for a knife, where you know, you pop the knife and you don't really look inside as such, and you don't really see that. So there are examples where it's desirable to line the leather. It could be for quality reasons. It could also be, for example, if it was a knife pouch, if you start to attach press studs or Sam Brown studs or anything that leaves metal on the flesh side of the leather, you may decide that you want to line the inside to then protect the knife from that metal, as opposed to using a little leather disc or something. So there's all different scenarios where you might want to line some leather. So let's say we had two pieces of leather. This is a piece of, it'd be about 3mm veg tan. This is a piece of that 0.8mm buffalo. So let's say that I wanted to line the veg tan with the buffalo. Now what I could do is I could just glue the buffalo to the veg tan, and then I could cut the edges flush so that they formed a solid edge like that. The reason that you might not do that is you're going to find it difficult to burnish that edge and make that edge nice. Because these, you've got two quite different thicknesses of leather, you've got two different types of leather, and you're going to struggle to burnish this thinner leather and struggle to bevel that thinner leather. It's not going to look very neat. So this is an example of where you might use this French binding. So you'll still end up with a lined piece of leather, but you'll also bind this cut edge here. So this involves stitching once or twice. The second level of stitching that you do, it adds strength, but it can also be mainly decorative, but it does look nice when it's done. So generally you would stitch twice with this, but you could get away with stitching once. So the first thing that we're going to do here is we're going to stick the skin side of the lining leather to the skin side of the piece of leather that we bind in. So as with the previous example, we want to bevel the edges so that when we fold that leather over, it's got a nice curve to fold round, and that'll just give it a nicer finished appearance. So we knock the edges off there, just the same as we did before, and then we can apply some glue. Now we're not going to apply a lot of glue to the edge in terms of width inwards, because we literally just want to tack this to the edge while we sew it. So we're only going to apply just a few millimetres of glue to the very edge there, the skin side of the lining leather. We'll apply just a couple of millimetres again there of glue. So once that's gone sticky, we'll stick these together. So just to be clear, that's the skin side of the leather, the flesh side's underneath, the glue's on the skin side of this lining, and that's the back side of the lining that we're looking at on the top there. So we're going to carefully align that and stick that down, and then again we'll be tapping that with a cobbler's hammer just to set that down. So we've basically got the two good sides of the leather facing each other inwards, and then the two back sides of the leather are on the outside. So the next thing we need to do with that is we need to make our hidden stitch line, and it's that stitch line which we will actually pull against when we make the roll. So what we do is we mark a parallel line down for stitching. Now how far in you mark that line is going to determine the width of your roll when you roll it over. So you could have a kind of a very tiny one, or you can make it a little bit bigger. It's up to you really, depending on the size that you want. So for this example, I'm going to mark about 4mm down from the edge. When you do the stitching, don't be tempted to make the stitches huge just because you can't see them. Because remember, you're going to pull against this stitch line when you do the roll, and if you do huge stitching, you'll find that it'll pull up with a kind of wonky edge. So you do need some relatively fine stitches. all the way down, and then just stitch this, and then we'll go on to the next stage. So there's the lining stitched across there, and give this a... Make sure that stitching's set nice and flat. So what we do next is we do the actual rollover part. So what we're going to do is we're going to apply glue to both sides of this. So we're going to apply glue to all the lining and then all the back. And also in a proper example, you'd have this measured out so that the lining was oversized to the back piece, and then you'd trim the edges of the lining off. So apply glue all over here. Glue on the inside as well. This is obviously gets quite awkward because of the shape of it and so on. So once that's ready to stick, what we're going to do is we're going to basically bring this round and over on itself then. So what we do first is we need to pull here, so it's kind of stretching it out, and then stick the roll down to itself so it's pulled nice and tight. So that's the bit where we're pulling it against the stitches there. And then we need to push and make sure that that part's formed nicely there. And then once we've done that, it can then get rolled over and stuck to the other side. Like that. And as I say, if you if you were doing this on a proper project, you'd need to make sure your lining leather was oversized to your actual front piece on all sides, so that you got a good stick down at the edge, and then you trim that off. So once that's turned over and stuck, again it can all be hammered down, including the roll, to flatten it down. And you do that all over your project. And then as well, you can take your bone folder and you can use that to rub and make sure that that edge is nice and straight and formed nicely there. So that's what that looks like then. That's how you create that roll. So we've hidden that line of stitches inside there now, as leather's pulled against those stitches. And then what we do now is, imagine that's the inside as well. Obviously that's now lined, so we can't see that flesh side there. So what we're doing now, as I say, is you can do a second line of stitches, if you like, because there are no stitches to see here at this point. And this, as I say, it will add some strength to a degree, but it is largely decorative, so it's kind of optional. It depends what you're making and whether you want to, you know, how much time you want to put into the project. So we'll put these stitches in just so we can see it to completion. So your stitches then sit underneath where your roll goes. So rather than trying to use a divider or anything, it needs to follow the line of the roll. So what I will do is I'll eyeball that along there, and I will then mark with a scratch hole there, and then we simply sew these two pieces together just the same as we did before. And to be honest, if I was making anything of any quality, I would put this line in if it's possible. Depends on the shape of the thing, but if it's possible, this looks really nice. So again, that's the stitching done across there now. So that just gives you the idea of what the finished thing looks like. And although it's kind of by accident, because I'm just using scraps, you get to see how you could use different colours with this to look nice as well. So, you know, you don't necessarily have to get a piece of black leather and a piece of black deer skin or something and have it all black. You know, you could use some different colours and put some contrast in, and you know, the brown stitching there quite nicely matches that brown lining and then contrasts against this natural coloured leather here. So, you know, it gives you some extra design options as well. But that's what that looks like. And obviously the second stitch line you can see on the inside, whereas the first stitch line is completely hidden. But certainly for things like bags or sort of fancy cases and various things like that, this can look really nice. For those of you that make a lot of knife sheaths like me, you can obviously use this to line pouch style knife sheaths. You can use it to on the top of a dagger style sheath as well. You can put a roll on the top, anywhere that you'd like to put the lining leather, and you can add this roll also. And they do look really nice. You know, it's a really classic look, and it gives it a really nice touch to the edge. So the only other thing to talk about with these is just to mention, if you're bringing two of these edges together, so let's imagine, I don't really make this big enough, but let's imagine that this was a wider sheath or something, and we were going to bring these around and close them here, so that was going to be the edge of a knife sheath. You can see how we've got essentially four layers of leather there now. We've got two lining layers and two veg tan layers. What you would want to do as you were bringing those round is you would want to skive back so that you just have the one the normal layers. So what you would do is you would carefully skive the lining leather away from the edge. So essentially you'd skive this back so that you could see the normal leather there on the inside, and then when you bring this round and close that together and obviously do your normal gluing and sanding and burnishing, you've just got those two layers there, and again that'll create a nicer burnish, because otherwise you'll get kind of a soft mushy layer in the middle, which is the lining leather, and it won't dye the same colour and it won't burnish properly. And so ideally you would bring that back round like that. I hope that makes sense. This obviously, you've got to imagine that that's quite a lot bigger. That's what you would do there. So obviously with the French one, we're at a stage where we can form the roll, we can pull the piece around, stick it there, and then work with that piece. On this wallet here, as an example, there's a piece of leather here, which is the back of the wallet. It forms the inside back, and then obviously this is the piece that's got all the credit card slots on. And the way that I do this is that the back actually then binds the edges of the front here. So if you see on this side, it's not actually been stitched yet, but you can see that this roll here, which looks similar to that roll we did on the French binding, that is actually formed from the back, as you can see here. So this piece here and this piece here will roll to come round here, and basically that's just done in reverse. So I will glue these pieces together here, so you can see where the guidelines are. That piece there and that piece there will be glued together, so that's rigid. And then what I do then is I basically cut this, and I fold it over halfway, like that, or just less than halfway. Glue that down, and then once that's glued, that's then folded over like that, so that it would match that side. And then once that's done, basically then I stitch through all of those layers of leather to bind them together. So it achieves a similar look, but there's no way that I could do that the other way around, because I couldn't attach the back first and then try and roll it round. It just wouldn't work. So there may be occasions when you're doing things where you kind of do it that way around, and that seems to work fine as well. Obviously you need to do everything very carefully, but it creates quite a nice look when it's done. So the last thing that we'll look at here is piping, and a piped seam is when you get sort of a almost like a rope-like piece running around the outside. And again, this is the kind of thing that you might choose to use on bags or something like that. I don't have a piece of the proper stuff that you can get for piping, so I'm just using a piece of paracord as a stand-in. But you can get also different sizes and thicknesses and things of the kind of rope that you use here from haberdashers and places like that. So how this is done. First of all, we make a piece that contains the piping. So I'm going to take an oversized piece of leather, and I'm going to simply apply glue all over. And once that glue's had time to go sticky, I'll take the piece of piping, pull it out straight, and lay it down the middle of the piece of leather, like that. And then what we'll do is we'll fold the leather over and stick it to itself around the piping, and then we'll push that around. So we've basically trapped the piece of piping inside the leather there. And what I want to do then, once that's dried, is just trim that off. So we'll just make sure we can see the edge, and then we need to leave a few millimetres there, which we're going to be able to stitch through, and then just trim that down. Now when you use something like this, this is usually going to be inside out. If you're making a bag or something, you'd probably sew it all inside out and then turn it back to front. So this is only really for sort of thin bags and things. It's not something that I'd normally do, to be honest. But it's kind of part of what we're looking at, so it's worth looking at. So what we do then, if we imagine this is the bag inside out, is we're going to take these pieces here and we're going to glue them to that fold there, like that, and we're going to glue one on either side. So once that's had a chance to go sticky, what we do is we glue this down and line this up. And again, if this is a large project, this is going to be much more difficult than this little example. You're going to have to do this quite carefully. But so again, imagine this is inside out. What you've got there now is you've got four layers of leather. You've got the two actual pieces of the bag, and you've got the two pieces of piping that have come together. And this is inside out at this stage. So what you want to do then is you want to stitch through all four of those pieces of leather. So I'll stitch this across and then I'll show you what it looks like. That's been stitched across there now. Remember, we're looking at this inside out. Once you've stitched it, you would probably want to tidy the edge up quite carefully, just so that you had a nice neat edge. To be honest, if you were doing piping, you would rarely see this, because if you were doing it on a bag or something, you'd probably want to line it. And the other place you'd see this, for example, might be on car seats or something like that. So if you think about a car seat, once it's car seat cover, you know, the upholstery part, it's turned inside out and then it's against the inside of the seat, so you'd never see it. But you need to do this quite carefully, because obviously you can't really lay the ruler flat. Put a straight edge against it, and then with a sharp knife, try not to carve any appendages off. Something like a scalpel works well for something delicate like that. Just trim that down. Obviously not coming too close to the stitching to weaken it, but just so you've got a nice straight edge. So if you imagine that's the inside of whatever it is, then obviously what we do then is we turn this inside out, and as you've got whatever the corner is of the item there, that's then your pipe in there, which you can see is basically going to run around the edge of whatever it is. And as I say, you can get proper cord for doing that. Don't put a piece of paracord in it as I have. It's just for an example. But it's probably a little bit thick actually for that. But if you think of it, it's like, it could be a settee or a car seat or something like that. It basically runs around the seam and makes a piped seam. You can obviously use colour with this as well. And similar to that French example, you could, if you think about like sports car seats or something, it might be black leather with red piping, something like that, so that you had like a red accent running around the seats. That'd look quite nice. It's really not something that I probably would ever do on a project. I've just covered it for the sake of completeness here, just to give you an idea. There's probably a slightly better ways of doing that, but just gives you an idea of how it goes together if it's something that you're wanting to use.